easiest way to think about your kidneys is they're a filter for your body. So you're drinking all this fluid in, you're eating foods, and the kidneys basically clean the blood. The blood comes in through the renal artery, it circulates through the kidney, and the kidney acts like a filter. All the bad stuff goes into the urine and goes down to your bladder, and the clean blood then goes back out the renal vein and circulates through your body again.
One of the saddest and most frustrating things that I see when I'm evaluating patients, my first question is always, tell me when you first knew about your kidney disease. And in a large proportion of patients, the story that I hear is, I walked in with very high blood pressure or a headache and they told me my kidneys had already failed. And I know that that process was going on for years, but you don't have symptoms until the very end.
There are a couple of diseases that make you very predisposed to kidney disease. The number one reason, especially in the United States, is diabetes. Diabetes is a disease that's nephrotoxic. You're not controlling your blood sugar levels, and eventually this goes on to hurt your kidneys. There's really two options for people. They can either get a living donor transplant or a deceased donor transplant.
With a kidney transplant, we're going to give you 4 to 5 times the function that dialysis gives you. We can talk about feeling better and better quality of life, and that's all important. But transplant is also one of the few things in medicine that actually extends life. People live longer with a transplant. If you take, for example, a typical American 50-year-old, if they're healthy, we expect them to live an extra 30 years. They'll live to about 80. The same 50-year-old on dialysis has a life expectancy, an average life expectancy of 8 years. If that 50-year-old gets a transplant, immediately their life expectancy jumps to 20 years, a significant increase in life.
To be determined as a candidate for transplant, whether that's from a living donor or a deceased donor, can expect the same thing. We still have to make sure that really the two major things are accomplished. They have to be safe to have an operation and safe to receive the immunosuppression, which is the medication that your immune system needs to be able to accept that organ for transplant. People, when they come to see us, they have an extensive workup to be able to establish those two things. The resources that are available here at the MedStar Georgetown Transplant Institute are second to none, but we need help from others to be able to do our job, meaning we need organs for transplant.
Living donor transplant provides a huge medical benefit for the recipient. So living donor organs tend to work faster and last longer. And so that can lead to a longer length of life and a better quality of life for the recipient. Some recipients who have been really sick before can feel incredibly better within days after the surgery. So, and most of the time when people come back in for their follow-up appointments, if everything's going well, kidney is working well, some of those people have a new lease on life. I mean, life totally changes for them after transplant.
People that are interested in being living donors, the first contact is the living donor connects with us. And living donation has become such a big part of our program. We have specific individuals at the Transplant Institute that just work for living donation.
My job consists of keeping patients ready for transplant at all times, making sure their testing is up to date, helping to allay any fears they may have towards transplant, making sure they have proper services that they need.
Eligibility for donation takes on a lot of different faces, but sort of the big picture is things like diabetes, frequent kidney stones, obesity, heart disease, and cancer. Those are kind of the big things that we say would rule out an individual from being a donor.
The good news here is that we have 40 years of data. We've done living donors since the 1960s, and every study has shown no change in the lifespan of people after kidney donation. About a third of all transplants are living donors, and we and other centers are doing everything we can to get people to be more open to the idea of living donation. What we often find is that we have donors willing to donate and recipients are nervous about their donors, as it's understandable that they are, but they're too nervous to ask or they don't know how to ask. But we do what we can to try and make that process easier on them and give them some ideas about how to ask and how to approach people. But it's really about being as broad and aggressive as we can have recipients be to find their donors. And it's amazing who does step up to donate. I've had a teacher donate to a student. I've had a landlord donate to a tenant. Just a couple of weeks ago, we had someone, and I said, "Who are you donating to?" And she said, "My auto mechanic." So I always tell people, cast a broad net. Consider widely. Don't assume that people are going to say no, because all you need is one person to say yes.